Today we'll talk about color in animation. The reason why I decided to study this topic was because I wanted to be able to explain to people what I do. I work in the movie industry as a texture and look development artist. I've worked on movies like Moana, Hotel Transylvania, SpongeBob, and Cats. Anyway, many people don't know what it means to be a look development artist or what exactly I do. And by trying to tell them what I do, I got very interested in the evolution of the coloring process in movies, and I did a big research. And today I'll be sharing here with you all a little bit of what I've learned during my research. It all started between the 19th and 20th century, more specifically by the end of 1880s and 1930s, when photography and cinema were evolving. Back then, as you all may know, the first pictures and movies were all in black and white. The new technology was cool, but it wasn't exactly like reality. Since the beginning of the black and white era, humanity felt that colorless images were unlike the human vision, and they started to test different techniques to change those monochromatic perceptions. So at first people started to hand paint their photographs. Then they had the idea to also hand paint the films. Now, can you imagine the amount of work that they had to do by hand painting each frame one by one? And that was the special effects of that time. Proudly, among the many people who used to hand paint pictures and films, we can highlight the achievements of one woman, the French Elisabeth Tullier. In 1887, she released her first hand painting work on a movie, and that caught the movie maker's attention. She studied and tried many techniques to apply color directly on film strips, and after specializing herself, she created a workshop to teach her technique to other people. She built a team made out of 200 women. Together, they painted many films for many filmmakers, and her strongest and most famous client was Méliès. They did, for example, the classic colored version of A Trip to the Moon. But hand painting each frame was a very time-consuming process. Each movie theater received a copy of a film, and there was no way to copy the colors, just the films. So after some trials and experiments, the first colorization technique to succeed in a practical way emerged in England, the Kinemacolor. This new technology used some kind of color gelatin filter to generate a little bit of color. It wasn't 100% perfect, but it was better than hand painting everything. In 1908, they made the very first exhibition showing the public the new technology. This new technology was commercialized to everyone that was making movies at the time, but the problem was that not all the theaters had the right equipment to reproduce the films with this new technique. It was expensive to replace all the projectors, and besides that, this gelatin filter that used to be placed behind the film cells, sometimes they used to get super dry, starting to crack, and that damaged the image quality. Besides these problems, the Kinemacolor had its moments of success as the best colorization process, but then came a very strong competitor, the American company Technicolor. You for sure have seen this name, Technicolor, in many movies and animations. Initially, they also used the same Kinemacolor technique, but parallel to that, they were also developing other ways to generate color in films. Kinemacolor achieved its success when, by the end of 1920s, they developed a technique composed of three color stripes, RGB. This technique was much better, super colorful, providing all the range of colors. The first machines with three color stripes from Technicolor were not for sale, and the equipment was very, very heavy. So the studios that wanted to have a colorful film could rent the Technicolor equipment, but they also had to hire the entire team. They had a team specialized in using the big cameras, a team to control the lights, someone to make the makeup and the costumes, etc. So it was a combo. It was necessary to have all these people to control the colors on the set. The topic of this workshop is color in animation, so I won't make comments about the use of color in movies with real people. However, it's worthy to make a very honorable mention to the classic and immortal The Wizard of Oz from 1939. This movie wasn't the first one to use the Technicolor technique, but they demonstrated and used it in a very clever way, the transition between monochromatic to color film. In 1931, one of the Technicolor owners, Herbert Kalmus, had a clever idea. He went to the Walt Disney Studios to convince them to make a trial testing their new technique. So here is the beginning of color in animation. At that time, all the animation movies were also done in black and white. And during the time that Herbert went to the Walt Disney Studios to offer his product, they were making a short film called Flowers and Trees. Disney and his team decided to make a test. After making this test, Disney agreed to hire the Technicolor team to make his short film Flowers and Trees, which was released in 1932. And this was not only the first fully colored cartoon, but also the first animated film ever to win an Oscar. Well, Disney was very smart and visionary, so he made an exclusivity contract with Technicolor. That meant that between 1932 and 1935, only the Walt Disney Studios could use this new three-color stripes technique. The other animation studios of that time, like MGM, Fleischer Brothers, Irby Iwerks, etc., they could use the two-color stripes film. So from 1932 to 1935, all the Disney animations called Silly Symphonies were super colorful, and that gave the studio not only more spotlight, but more Oscars and other awards. But even with all the Technicolor technology, the animated movies still had to hand paint frame by frame. So Disney had to expand his team and created a new department, the ink and paint. The head of this new department was Hazel Sewell. She was Walt Disney's sister-in-law and was the first woman to lead a department. So Sewell led the animation industry's first team entirely composed of women. As I said, the ink and paint department were composed only by women. They had to take the drawings done by the animators, which was originally done on paper, and then they had to clean up the shape, outlining it with a black ink, and then in a transparent cell, they had to flip it and paint behind the ink.
The thousands of pencil drawings go to the inking department. Here, hundreds of pretty girls, in a comfortable building all their own, well lighted, air conditioned throughout, cover the drawings with sheets of transparent celluloid. Then they painstakingly trace every line of every drawing in ink, following exactly in every detail the original animation drawings. Now the picture moves into its final stage, color. In the studio paint laboratory, all colors used are made up from secret formulas. Expert chemists develop more than 1,500 different shades of color for Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. The ink celluloids next go to the painting department, where more pretty girls apply the final colors on the back.
This transparent cell paper were very expensive, so after finishing a project and capturing all the images, they used to wash the painting to reuse the paper. So today the remaining original ink and paint cells that still exists are very expensive. And now I want to raise a controversy here. Today, everyone who is interested in animation and animation history knows the classic Disney animators. They were recognized, especially the Nine Old Men. They received credits and films, but the ink and paint women were overlooked. So now I ask you, do you prefer to watch a movie only with the lines in black and white or in color? Years later, some letters and testimonies from this woman came to the public. Some reported that they used to work 85 hours a week and earned much less than the animators. Others watched the sunset and rise, etc. There is even a letter that Disney sent to a woman who applied in the studio to be an animator, but Disney made it clear that women could only work doing painting because the creative part was made by men. In 2017, Melinda Johnson wrote a book dedicated to all these female artists, Ink and Paint, the Woman of Walt Disney Animation.
My name is Mindy Johnson, and I'm the author of a new book called Ink and Paint, the Women of Walt Disney's Animation. Walt pretty much reached tremendous success with Mickey Mouse and the Silly Symphonies, but he felt that there was much more that could be accomplished with animation. Initially, the artist used black, white, and about three or four shades of gray paint. That was it. Walt really wanted to push boundaries, and where his animators were being trained and expanding their work, the women went to work with the idea of color. I underestimated this topic. I thought that it would be a charming book about the women and their roles in animation because I had been led to believe that that's all it was. But I couldn't have been further from the truth. When people think of animation today, or even animation history, we have a real limited view of where women were. We know of Mary Blair, Retta Scott, and certainly they are extraordinary artists, but women were everywhere. Well, certainly the animation is vital, it's important, it's the movement, it's that illusion of life. But what the women applied in color, you cannot deny. These women broke extraordinary ground and accomplished a level of artistry that is just unsurpassed in any area of animation. Very much like the canvas that these women worked on, those invisible cells, their work was invisible. And it's an opportunity to lift the lid on this slice of film history, of world history, pop culture history, and it's told in as many personal accounts as possible. So in their voices, you're getting an opportunity to hear their stories and marvel at the artistry of what was accomplished.
The same ink and paint process was adopted in many studios, and that became a standard.
From the in-betweeners, the pencil drawings pass on to the cartoon inkers. The inkers trace the sketches on squares of celluloid. For short, they are called cells. They provide the characters with an invisible support and facilitate their arrangement with other figures as well as backgrounds. The ink drawings are then filled in with color. At the stockroom counter, painters or fillers in replenish their ever-dwindling color supplies. Great care must be exercised by the paint mixers. As a large group of painters are currently working with the same colors, the shades that all are using must match perfectly. Any variance in color will be noticeable on the screen. In filling in the outlines, the figures are reversed as the paint is applied, so the cells, when placed before the camera to be photographed, will present a smooth, glossy surface with no suggestion of paint or brush lines. Now the characters must be provided with a fitting environment.
By the end of 1950s, Ubi Iwerks, who started his career at Disney, then he left to make his own studio, but he returned to Disney. Anyway, it's a long story. He started to test a new technology called Xerox. So he used to take the original drawings from the animators, make a copy on a acetate paper, this transparent cell paper, and that eliminated the ink stage, so a woman just had to paint behind this copy of friends. The first time they tested this technique was on one of the dragon scenes from the Sleeping Beauty movie in 1959. And the first movie done entirely with the Xerox copy using the animator's original line was in 101 Dalmatians. In 1961. Disney, he didn't like the result, but it was well accepted by the public. So not only the movies, but also the TV shows at the time, like the ones done at Warner, Hanna-Barbera, etc., were also done with the same ink and paint technique. Anyway, during the 60s, 70s, the technology remained basically the same. Then came the 80s and the first personal computers. In 1988, Disney released Oliver and Friends, which was the last movie entirely 100% hand-painted. Then in 1989, they also released The Little Mermaid, that was also hand-painted, but in one of the final scenes, they tested the first digitally painted sequence. The movies that came after Little Mermaid, like Beauty and the Beast, Lion King, etc., used the so-called computer animation production system. The animators would still animate on paper, but the painting would be done on a computer. Until 1994, the Disney studios didn't reveal the public that the films were being painted digitally, fearing that the magic would go out if people discovered that computers were involved in the process. This technology was used until 2004. After that, the animation process also started to be done digitally using a software called Toon Boom. And now that we arrived in the 90s decade, in our color and animation chronology, here starts a new chapter, the 3D. The first 3D feature film was Toy Story in 1995. But before Toy Story, Pixar did 5 short films, which served as the laboratory to test the new 3D technique. On Toy Story credits, a textural look development artist, they were called CG painter and shader. And this is, in my opinion, the new ink and paint department. When you model something in your computer, it's normally gray by default. And this is what I do today for the movie industry. I do the digital paint on top of a 3D model. But it's not only painting, we need to create a variety of maps to get a correct aspect to each material and apply these maps to a shader. It's a process that is both artistic and technical. The computers and 3D process started to evolve and new softwares emerged. Initially, most of the studios were painting on software similar to Photoshop. Today we have a big variety in the market to paint the 3D textures. Mari, Substance Painter, ZBrush, 3D Code, etc. For those who don't know, I started my career as a traditional 2D animator and I dedicated 6 years of my life to it, studying and working. But then, in order to get more job opportunities, I had to learn 3D. I've learned it alone with YouTube tutorials. In 2011, I finally got my first job as a 3D generalist. A generalist is someone who does a little bit of everything. But then, also in 2011, I watched the movie Rango. That movie was mind-blowing for me because the characters were very cartoony, but they had a very realistic treatment. They were very well painted. The textures of this movie really impacted me, so I decided to go after more information. And I found out that the software that they used to paint this movie was the same one that was developed during the movie Avatar 1 year before. So I had to learn that. I got really fascinated. In 2012, thanks to all my work that I did in Brazil, I won an art scholarship to study in Germany with all expenses paid. When I started at the Film Academy Baden-Württemberg, I was the only Brazilian student and also the only student at the time who knew how to use the software called Mari. So the students started to spread the word and everyone wanted me to paint their 3D projects. And that's also one of the reasons why I became a texture and look development artist. So this was a brief history about the coloring animation. The history is much longer, it has much more films and softwares that contributed somehow to what we know today. I hope that this small workshop could show you the importance of all the artists who brought and keep bringing color to the movies. Without the ink and paint ladies from Disney, the films would be boring, and in 3D, even the greatest 3D models would not be the same without the texturing, shading, lighting. All the departments work together to make a movie, and they should all be equally valued. Well, that's all, folks. I hope you enjoyed this video. Bye!